Hello, and welcome to another video from the YouTube channel, From Religion to Agnostic. Today we will be looking into Lamech, Noah's father. Now I have mentioned some yes, very off-the-wall suggestions, or one would think, from a religious point of view, but I assure you take a step back and look at things. First thing is first, start questioning. Yes, you heard me correctly, start questioning the contradictions in the Torah. I know many of you think that the Hebrew is the first language. I thought so too till I came to realize there was a form of writing before that. It's called cuneiform. You find it in, that's right, the Epic of Gilgamesh, Sumerian writings, which we have mentioned in past videos on this channel. Kinda funny, especially when you look at the Sumerian and realize that the Code of Hammurabi has many of the so-called laws that are in your Torah. So now I beg to ask the question. Which came first? The chicken, or the egg? The Torah, written and rewritten, paced together and many things redacted. As it was being paced together, or these writings carved into stone, and can't be altered without being obvious. So just keep that in mind as we go on. What we have on Lamech is very little compared to Lamech of Cain's line. Lamech was a patriarch in the genealogies of Adam in the book of Genesis. He is part of the genealogy of Jesus in Luke 3:36. According to the book of Jasher, Yasher, specify, Lamech's wife was named Ashmua, Jasher 4:11. Lamech is also mentioned in Islam in the various collections of tales of the prophets who preceded Muhammad, which mentions him in an identical manner. The Bible's narrative for Lamech, and Lamech lived in 182 years, and begot a son. And he called his name Noah, saying, This same shall comfort us concerning our work and toil of our hands, because of the ground which the Lord hath cursed. And Lamech lived after he begot Noah 595 years, and begot sons and daughters. And all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. Genesis 5:28 31, King James Version. And the Bible's genealogy for Lamech. Lamech is the eighth generation descendant of Adam, Genesis 5:25, the son of Methuselah, and the father of Noah, Genesis 5:29, in the genealogy of Seth in Genesis 5. In Genesis 5:12-25, Lamech was a son of Methuselah, who was a grandson of Jared, who was a grandson of Kenan descended from Adam. Genesis 5:28-31 records that Lamech was 182, according to the Masoretic text, 188 according to the Septuagint, years old at the birth of Noah and lived for another 595 years, attaining an age at death of 777 years, 5 years before the flood in the Masoretic chronology. With such numbers in this genealogical account, Adam would still have been alive for about the first 56 years of Lamech's life. And so that's all the Bible gives for Lamech, but when you go into Jewish sources. But before we do, I want to point out quickly, that when looking into this Code of Hammurabi, many things seem to have been taken from there and re-edited, and put into the laws in the Bible. Not to mention that many scholars believe that Hammurabi and Moses W.H.E. are the same figure. From Wiki, on the Code of Hammurabi it states. Modern scholars responded to the code with admiration, at its perceived fairness and respect for the rule of law, and at the complexity of old Babylonian society. There was also much discussion of its influence on the Mosaic law. Scholars quickly identified Lex Talionis, the eye for an eye principle, as underlying the two collections. Debate among Assyriologists has since centered around several aspects of the code: its purpose, its underlying principles, its language, and its relation to earlier and later law collections. Despite the uncertainty surrounding these issues, Hammurabi is regarded outside Assyriology as an important figure in the history of law, and the document as a true legal code. The U.S. Capitol has a relief portrait of Hammurabi alongside those of other lawgivers, and there are replicas of the steel in numerous institutions, including the headquarters of the United Nations in New York City and the Pergamon Museum in Berlin. As well as the Code of Hammurabi bears strong similarities to earlier Mesopotamian law collections. Many purport to have been written by rulers, and this tradition was probably widespread. Earlier law collections express their God-given legitimacy similarly. Like the Code of Hammurabi, they feature prologues and epilogues. The Code of Ur-Nammu has a prologue, the Code of Lipit-Ishtar a prologue and an epilogue, and the Laws of Eshnunna an epilogue. Also, like the Code of Hammurabi, they uphold the one crime, one punishment principle. The cases covered and language used are, overall, strikingly similar. Scribes were still copying, e.g., the code of Ur-Nammu when Hammurabi produced his own code. This suggests that earlier collections may have not only resembled the code but influenced it. Raymond Westbrook maintained that there was a fairly consistent tradition of ancient Near Eastern law, which included the Code of Hammurabi, and that this was largely customary law. Nonetheless, there are differences. For example, Stephen Burtman has suggested that where earlier collections are concerned with compensating victims, the code is concerned with physically punishing offenders. Additionally, the above conclusions of similarity and influence apply only to the law collections themselves. The actual legal practices from the context of each code are mysterious. The Code of Hammurabi also bears strong similarities to later Mesopotamian law collections, to the casuistic Middle Assyrian laws and to the Neo-Babylonian laws, whose format is largely relative. It is easier to posit direct influence for these later collections, given the code's survival through the scribal curriculum. Lastly, although influence is more difficult to trace, there is evidence that the Hittite laws may have been part of the same tradition of legal writing outside Mesopotamia proper. The relationship of the Code of Hammurabi to the Mosaic Law, specifically the Covenant Code of Exodus 20:22-23:19, has been a subject of discussion since its discovery. Friedrich Delitzsch argued the case for strong influence in a 1902 lecture, in one episode of the Babel und Bibel, Babel and Bible, or Pan-Babylonism, debate on the influence of ancient Mesopotamian cultures on ancient Israel. However, he was met with strong resistance. There was cultural contact between Mesopotamia and the Levant, and Middle Bronze Age tablets of casuistic cuneiform law have been found at Hazor. There are also similarities between the Code of Hammurabi and the Covenant Code, in the casuistic format, in principles such as lex talionis, eye for an eye, and in the content of the provisions. Some similarities are striking, such as in the provisions concerning a man-goring ox, Code of Hammurabi Laws 250-252, Exodus 21:28-32. Certain writers have posited direct influence. David P. Wright, for example, asserts that the Covenant Code is directly, primarily, and throughout dependent upon the laws of Hammurabi, a creative rewriting of Mesopotamian sources, to be viewed as an academic abstraction rather than a digest of laws. Others posit indirect influence, such as via Aramaic or Phoenician intermediaries. The consensus, however, is that the similarities are a result of inheriting common traditions. In 1916, George A. Barton cited a similarity of antecedents and of general intellectual outlook. More recently, David Winton Thomas has stated, there is no ground for assuming any direct borrowing by the Hebrew from the Babylonian. Even where the two sets of laws differ little in the letter, they differ much in the spirit. The influence of the Code of Hammurabi on later law collections is difficult to establish. Mark van de Mierop suggests that it may have influenced the Greek Gordon Code and the Roman 12 Tables. However, even van de Mierop acknowledges that most Roman law is not similar to the Code, or likely to have been influenced by it. Knowing the Code's influence on modern law requires knowing its influence on Mosaic and Greco-Roman law. Since this is contentious, commentators have restricted themselves to observing similarities and differences between the Code and, example, United States law and medieval law. Some have remarked that the punishments found in the Code are no more severe, and, in some cases, less so. Okay, so I will leave a link in the description box for this Code of Hammurabi. Let's see what the Jewish sources say. According to thetorah.com, by Dr. Rabbi Samuel Z. Glazer. Isaac's Divine Conception? The Lord visited Sarah, Gen 21:1, when God, and his angels, appears to Abraham to announce the birth of Isaac. The text implies a hidden visit to Sarah. Does this mean, as both Philo and Paul claim, that Isaac was born from a divine conception? Why God and the two men and angels inquire about Sarah? After Abraham circumcises his household and himself, Yahweh appears to him while he is sitting in his tent. As the story unfolds, Abraham sees three men standing near him. According to the straightforward reading of the text, it is Yahweh plus two angels. After they eat, they inquire about the absent Sarah. Genesis 18:9, they said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he replied, "There, in the tent." Oddly, even though this verse suggests that the men are looking for her, the story simply continues with the men speaking to Abraham. Genesis 18:10, and he said, "I will return to you at the due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." Sarah was listening at the entrance of the tent, which was behind him, highlighting Sarah's modesty. The rabbis notice this problem, and offer some homiletical suggestions, B. Bava Mitzia 87a. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he replied, "There, in the tent." This comes to teach that our mother Sarah was modest. Rav Yehuda said in the name of Rav, and some say Rabbi Yitzhak, the ministering angels knew that our mother, Sarah, was in the tent. So what was the question leading to Abraham's response, "In the tent, for?" In order to make her beloved to her husband. According to this answer, the angels were just trying to get Abraham to notice how modest Sarah was by calling his attention to the fact that she wasn't there. To give Sarah a cup of blessing. The Talmud records yet another answer. Rabbi Yossi B. Rabbi Chanina said, to be able to pass her the cup of blessing. This interpretation suggests that the angels sent Sarah back the cup of wine that was blessed during the meal, a rabbinic custom familiar from the Talmud. Although neither of these answers fit with the simple meaning of the text, they highlight the lacuna. Having asked where Sarah is, why does the story change course and simply continue with the visitors' conversation with Abraham? Did someone go in the tent? In the MT of V9, the word, Aleph, Lamed, Yod, Vav, has dots called punctia extraordinaria, which, according to the rabbis, communicate some sort of hesitation about the whether the word or words or letters really belong in the biblical text. Genesis Rabbah, 48:9, Theodore Albeck, interprets. And they said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" Genesis 18:9, the letters Aleph, Yod, Vav have dots, the lamed has no dots. R. Azariah says, just as they said to Abraham, "Where is she?" thus they said to Sarah, "Where is he?" R. Azariah here assumes that the dots communicate a missing scene, namely that the angels entered the tent and spoke with Sarah directly. The change of verb tense from the plural, they said, in verse 9 to the singular, he said, in verse 10 implies a change of scene. In the first scene, all three angels are speaking with Abraham, and the next scene, only one announces Sarah's pregnancy and the future birth of Isaac. In between these two speeches, the angels entered the tent to be with Sarah. Why does the text imply a scene with Sarah secluded with angels? Is it possible that this visit was not merely to announce that Sarah would become pregnant but is also explaining how Sarah, a menopausal woman, becomes miraculously pregnant? And Yahweh pakaded Sarah. Support for this possibility comes from the description of Isaac's birth, Genesis 21:1, Yahweh visited Sarah as he had promised, and Yahweh did for Sarah as he had spoken. The verse is written with poetic parallelism. Yahweh pakeds Sarah and he does what he promised. The root, b, kuf, dalet, has a broad semantic range in the Bible. In this context, it can mean, remember, take care of, or, visit. The idea that God visited Sarah goes together with the verb, to do, ayin, shin, hey, which is used in the parallel hemistich. When did this visit take place? Ramban, 1194-1270, suggests that it must have occurred sometime between the visit in chapter 18 when Sarah's pregnancy was announced and when Sarah gave birth in chapter 21, since in that passage, God promises to return, otherwise the promise of a future visit is never fulfilled. The Holy One, blessed be He, said here, Genesis 18:14, "I will return to you at the time," and whether this refers to an angel or God, we do not find that he ever returned at some time. Perhaps, this is referred to in the words, Genesis 21:1, "God visited Sarah as he had promised." Nevertheless, Genesis 21:1 could also be referring to the very visit recorded in chapter 18. Both texts are attributed to J. in source critical scholarship, documentary hypoesis, J. factor. According to this, the verse is telling us that when Yahweh visited Sarah, he caused her to conceive. Yahweh further communicates this fact when he promises that when he returns in the future, Sarah would already be with child, Genesis 18:14. In other words, the verse affirms what God did for Sarah then, i.e., that he caused her to become pregnant during that visit. Either way, the cryptic allusion to God's visit to Sarah implies that contact with, or proximity to, the divine was necessary for her to conceive. This need not be understood as something sexual in the style of a god seducing a human woman like we find in Greek myths. In fact, nothing in the Isaac story implies lust on the part of the divine being, but only grace towards an elderly barren woman, married to one of Yahweh's faithful worshippers. Divine conceptions. The birth of Isaac is not the only place in the Bible in which a divine or angelic conception is implied. Number 1. When Eve names Cain, Genesis 4:1, she explains his name by saying, "I have created a man with Yahweh." Number 2. The children of God are said to have propagated with women and produced giants, Genesis 6:1-4. Number 3. The second temple works, 1 Enoch, 106, and Genesis Apocryphon, Column 2, both describe how Noah's father, Lamech, was worried that Noah was the product of a divine being and not his own son. Number 4. Samson seems to be the product of a union between Manoah's wife and a visiting angel. Unlike the children of God account, nothing carnal is implied in the Isaac story, only that Sarah needed to be in physical proximity to the deity in order for the miraculous conception to take effect. Philos, Mystery of Isaac. Philo of Alexandria, ca. 20 BCE to 50 CE, the most influential Jewish Hellenistic philosopher, explicitly read the account of Isaac's birth as referring to divine conception. He believed that an important philosophical mystery inhered in the story of Isaac's birth. Isaac represents joy, his name means laughter, because he is one with the power behind the universe. This is because Isaac is actually God's son and not Abraham's. When happiness, that is Isaac, was born, she says, in the pious exaltation, "The Lord has caused me laughter, and whoever shall hear of it shall rejoice with me." Open your ears, therefore, O ye initiated, and receive the most sacred mysteries. Laughter is joy, and the expression, "has caused," is equivalent to, "has begotten." So that what is here said has some such meaning as this: "The Lord has begotten Isaac." Allegorical Laws, 3:2-19, Yonj Trans. "And I will bring forward as a competent witness in proof of what I have said, the most holy Moses. For he introduces Sarah as conceiving a son when God beheld her by himself, but he represents her as bringing forth her son, not to him who beheld her then, but to him who was eager to attain to wisdom, and his name is called Abraham." On the Cherubs, 45, Yonj Trans. In one passage, on the change of names, 131, Philo even calls Isaac God's son. Howard Schwartz, a scholar of Bible and Jewish thought, explains Philo's exegesis. How does Philo arrive at this explanation? He interprets Sarah's comment that, "God has caused me laughter," Genesis 21:6, to mean that the Lord has begotten Isaac. He interprets "has caused" to mean "begotten," and he substitutes Isaac for "laughter," since "Isaac" means "laughter," referring to Sarah's laughter in Genesis 18:12, when the angel said that she would have a child even though Sarah was 90 years old. Although Philo is more interested in the philosophical implications of this divine conception, he is basing it on a reading of the text similar to the one suggested above. From Philo to Paul, Paul of Tarsus, c. 5-67 CE, appears to have shared this idea. His letter to the Galatians states, Galatians 4:22, "It is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman and the other by a free woman." Galatians 4:23-1, "The child of the slave was born according to the flesh, the other, the child of the free woman, was born through the promise." In explaining Paul's exegesis, Daniel Boyarin writes, "It should be noted that in the biblical text, it is not stated that Abraham knew Sarah his wife after the Annunciation. There may have even been, then, a tradition that the conception of Isaac was entirely by means of the promise. The point would be that Hagar had sex with a man in order to conceive, but Sarah did not. Paul was likely influenced by Philo's thinking here, whether directly, Philo was an older contemporary of Paul, or because Philo's allegories were in the air among Hellenistic Jews reading the Pentateuch. Purging divine conception from Judaism, ironically, Paul's adoption of Philo's reading and his application of the concept to Jesus likely sealed its fate among Jewish interpreters. The New Testament traditions of Jesus' birth through the Holy Spirit, Matthew 1:18, Luke 1:35, rendered any such idea anathema, even as applied to Isaac and even without the connotations of divinity familiar from Christian theology. Jewish tradition thus permanently rejected Philo's Mystery of Isaac. Nevertheless, certain clues in the text point to the possibility that Philo was reading the Torah correctly all along. Okay, and so that's it for Lamech. Have a great day, and be safe. If you enjoyed this video, Please think about subscribing, as well as hitting the like and sharing would help out a lot. Thank you all, peace out, people.